go ahead and get started. Happy to see a packed room, and some folks are going to trickle in. So if by chance there is a seat open against the wall, if you wouldn't mind scooting over, so when folks come in late, they have some place to sit, that would be excellent. I'm Jessica Light, faculty in Wildlife and Fishery Sciences, and this is our second speaker for the Animal Conservation Seminar Series that the department has recently started. And it's my pleasure to introduce the speaker. This is Dr. Marcella Kelly. She is a native Californian. She's got her bachelor's and PhD from the University of California, Davis, and then pretty soon, directly thereafter, landed a job at Virginia Tech, where she is now a full professor. And I was trying to figure out nice ways to summarize her research, but her website's great. So here's a summary statement of what she does, which we'll be hearing about today. She uses population dynamics framed in an ecological context and cutting-edge technology to ultimately promote conservation of wildlife species. That cutting-edge technology is work that she's pioneered of using camera tracking techniques and using those images of animals that she's getting to help understand the population dynamics of the organisms that she's working with. In terms of organisms that she has worked with, the list is huge if you look at her list of publications. So I'll ramble a few off. Jaguars, pumas, ocelots, cheetahs, coyotes, tigers, bats, bears, salamanders, horseshoe crabs, wolves, lemurs, cape fox, black bears, leopards, civets, small mammals, and a whole bunch of other things. So she's working with tons of animals using these techniques. And working in multiple different locations, primarily in the neotropics, especially Belize, but other places include Madagascar, Sumatra, Nepal, Botswana, and local research as well. With working with a variety of different organisms in different areas, you can imagine the funding sources are quite diverse. So there's World Wildlife Federation, Department of Transportation in various states that she's been in, and a variety of other sources, U.S. Department of Agriculture. And she's very active in her wildlife society, both the local wildlife society as well as national, and she is a recognized leader in conservation. And if you go to her website, you'll see so much more in addition to what we're going to learn about today. I want to remind everybody that we are having a happy hour this afternoon, approximately starting around 4:30 at Rough Draft on Northgate. So if you're interested in talking to Dr. Kelly Moore, please come to that, and I'll make the announcement again at the end of the seminar. So without that, go for it.
Thanks, Jessica, and thanks a lot for inviting me. Great. So what I thought I would do today is kind of give you a general overview, not only of my research, but also kind of my path and how I kind of got to where I got. And so I'll start with how I got really interested in carnivore kind of interactions was with my PhD research on cheetahs. And I like to put this picture in here. This is Ann Hilborn, who is my PhD student now, working on the same population that I worked on when I was a graduate student, even though I stopped working on cheetahs when I was a grad student, and now I'm kind of back around to them. So this is sort of the first non-invasive sampling, but in this case, it wasn't remote camera traps. This is a great ecosystem. You can actually see your study animal. You can drive around and take photographs of them and get these great photographs of animals. And so what my job was, when I was much younger as a graduate student, my PhD advisor said, I've got this great PhD project for you. You're going to work on cheetahs. And I'm like, yes, I'm going to work on cheetahs. And here they are. Here's all my cheetahs. So they're in these boxes, 25,000 photographs of cheetahs over a 25-year data set. So it was really, really cool, except that I didn't get to do a whole lot of field work. I got to do a little bit of field work, but primarily I was the one looking at spot patterns for a year and a half to identify every single cat from when it was a tiny little cub to when it grew up and became an adult, because their spot patterns are individually distinct. So all cats have, all spotted cats have individually distinct spot patterns. Why this population is super interesting is because poor cheetahs suffer kleptoparasitism, so lions steal their prey. And they also suffer interguild predation, so lions kill their cubs. And so this is a very strong source of competition. And so when I was looking at the cheetah data, so I'm going to give you just a few slides on some of the interesting PhD research. Well, I think it's interesting is that what was obvious from the photographs in pre-1980, cheetahs were able to pull off these large litters, up to six cubs pretty commonly. Four, five, and six were pretty common. After 1980, not so much. So one cub was much more common, two if they were lucky. And all these measures of reproductive success were declining. So pre pre-1980, we would have 2.9 cubs to independence, whereas post-1980, 2.1. So all of these measures of reproductive success were declining. And we know that most of that was due to predation. So Karen Lawrenson was doing some work at the same time. Cheetahs suffer tremendously from predation. So a cheetah cub itself only has about a 5% chance of survival to make it to adulthood. Most of that mortality is due to lions and hyenas, and pretty much most of it is due to lions. So it's hyenas do add, but it's mostly lions that are knocking off these cheetah cubs. And what happened in 1980 was female lions, which is this dotted line here, almost doubled on the Serengeti, on the plains in around 1980. And so it's correlational. We don't have the exact data to say for sure it was lions, but it's a pretty striking pattern. So that led me to do lots of population analysis. And at the time, this would have been kind of mid to late 90s. Population viability. We were still in this world of doing a lot of population viability analysis, so I wanted to see if you modeled lions and different numbers of lions, how would that impact extinction risk of cheetahs, at least theoretically. And so what we found was we were actually able to kind of nail it, like what number of lions you needed. If you kept below 72 lions on the plains, cheetahs actually did pretty well, so they had really low extinction risk. They weren't not likely to go extinct through time. But as soon as you started bumping up into the 98 to 100 animals on the plains for lions, you saw dramatic increases in extinction risk. So they wouldn't be able to withstand this much predation all the time. So that was kind of the background on how I got interested in that. Oh, but then one other slide is just showing you that this is across national parks, and we've got lion biomass on the x-axis and cheetah biomass on the Y, and basically what you're seeing here is that those are national parks in Africa. As that lion biomass increases, cheetah biomass declines. So, and that's corrected for prey biomass, but suffice it to say, cheetahs and lions don't do well together, they don't play well together. And so at the same time, lots of people were writing about umbrella species and all of these kind of things. And I was thinking, well, you could never really use a lion then as an umbrella species. So this concept that one species can protect, if it's doing well, everything else under its umbrella is doing well, does not apply for this cheetah lion problem where you've got two endangered species and one does not fare well when the other one is around. And again, this is a late 90s. I was also really influenced by a colleague of mine, Kevin Crooks, who wrote this paper in Nature talking about when you remove coyotes from an ecosystem, you get large increases in feral cats, which then hammer the songbirds. And so this was a pretty sort of famous paper in terms of the trophic cascade dynamics, which then led to this idea that you've got mesopredator release. So you've got a super predator. If they're gone from the ecosystem, the mesopredator increases and hammers the prey. So these were all the kinds of ideas I was thinking about. And so you could try to tackle this by looking at different density estimates or different spatial patterns in these carnivores arrangements across the landscape. Okay, so, but I was also surprised at the fact that nobody was really talking about these two ideas of the umbrella species being at odds with the idea of mesopredator release. And I would use the two concepts sometimes in the same grant proposal. I was like, oh, are they going to notice that I've just argued that jaguars are an umbrella species, but then I'm also talking about if you have a lot of jaguars, you might not have pumas and ocelots. So I started to get bothered by this and then was trying to decide whether or not, well, is a jaguar or another cat? We know lions can't be an umbrella species. They definitely go into that mesopredator release thing. But what about something like a jaguar? I was thinking about switching ecosystems now. So I looked it up, and Wikipedia said it. So I said, OK, I guess a jaguar is an umbrella species. So defined as an umbrella species online on Wikipedia, except that nobody has proven this or shown anything, except some work in Barrow, Colorado Island, which has actually shown the opposite, that when you get jaguars into the system, if they swim out to the island, the ocelots crash. So there is information out there, but it's only from island systems. So I was like, I want to move into different ecosystems. So that's just a little bit of background on the ecological questions that I was trying to answer and still trying to answer about what is your, what is causing the how is this ecosystem constructed with these predators? Is it a mesopredator release thing, or is it if one predator does well, they all do well in different ecosystems besides Serengeti? Okay, so I'm going to for this talk, then I'm going to go into these three case studies. The first one is the jaguar puma ocelot study. The next one is the Sumatran tiger and multiple other wild felids. And then the last one at the end, I just have a little bit of work on Madagascar that I'll talk about with all these crazy little carnivores that nobody knows anything about. So we've gotten a little bit of information about them. Okay, so I'll start with the first case study. And the first thing to note is that there was like no data when I went out there to figure out, you know, besides Barrow, Colorado Island, what's going on and why isn't there data from the neotropics? And part of it is they're darn hard to study in these forested environments. So there's our second jaguar in there. They're just really, really elusive. There's no way that you're going to go out, and maybe, you know, I was naive because I had been used to the Serengeti ecosystem, that you'd go out, oh, you just watch these animals. Well, there's no watching animals in rainforests. If anyone's been to the rainforest, you know, you're lucky if you hear something. That's pretty good. And seeing a large predator is nearly impossible. So I'm going to focus on, or where I decided to do this work was in Belize in Central America, that blue circle. And we've got multiple study sites across this country. And suffice it to say, I'm not going to go into the whole story about why I chose Belize, but I did have a project that failed miserably there on a previous PhD project. So I fell back on the cheetah data. So if any grad students tell me their woe story, I've got a real serious woe story of a failed PhD project. But I always loved the country, so I taught study abroads there and got to know the place up and down. And so I decided, this is it. We're going to do mesopredator release or umbrella species in Belize. So another thing I kind of wanted to do through this talk is highlight some of these techniques that really have enabled this work to be done. Because you can't observe these animals firsthand, you really need to go out and use other techniques. So remote cameras was one of the first techniques I started using, then moving into scat dogs, then some areas we just did sign surveys with tracks and other various signs, and then scat sampling and fecal DNA to do genetic mark recapture. Okay, so I'll be highlighting these throughout. And the other thing I was really influenced by was, again, in the late 90s, Ulas Karanth and Jim Nichols did this kind of study for tigers. And here I thought I had made up this whole great idea that I was going to do mark recapture with jaguars, and I was going to use remote cameras. And back in the day when, you know, at this time there wasn't really internet yet, so I had missed this paper. This was not on my radar. And so I submitted this grant proposal to WCS. And they said, this is great, and you should look at this paper. It's not you're not the first one to do it. And so I was like, oops, my bad. But they gave me the grant anyway. So I went on to start doing this mark recapture. So again, you need captures of individuals, and they need to be individually identifiable. And then you can set your cameras across the landscape and get back your captured animals and create their capture histories and estimate density. So back in the day, these were all film cameras, so that was a nightmare trying to keep film with your 36 exposures running over the course of 3 months in very wet environments. And the learning curve was pretty steep for me. I had worked in savanna habitat in Africa. I hadn't really worked, besides study abroad, I hadn't really actually tried to do work in the tropics. So there's lots of this kind of stuff that happens. Trees go down and they might be poison wood, which you might be allergic to, like me. Lots of getting stuck in the mud. There's a rental car that I sank. Yeah, you should, if anyone's seen field work fails, yeah, the rental cars, you should really, they should ask you if you're a field biologist for sure. Some areas were very much a little bit dangerous, so we had to take military to help keep us safe. Some areas we had to bolt our cameras into concrete pods to keep them from being stolen. So, I mean, all these like crazy things that I never thought I would ever be doing just to try to do science, you know. So, and then this one I like. This is the field work fails one where Eddie, who's sitting, he's the second from your left, was a Marine and was like, I am never working for you again. That was such a hard project. So, and that was, again, another rental car. So anyway, that was just the, like, okay, try not to do these things anymore. At the beginning, you just are way too gung-ho, and we're going to do this. But you end up losing a lot of time, and you kill your team. So we've become a lot more efficient at doing this camera trapping stuff. When there are no roads, though, we did a whole bunch of work about trying to get camera traps into the jungle by just cutting our own trails. So my first graduate student, I made Adam do a lot of that work. And this was funny because lots of people ask me now, how do you camera trap when there's no roads? I said, well, that's tough because at the beginning we cut our own trails and we chopped through the jungle and made these trails and then we got no photographs. And it was a complete waste of an enormous amount of effort. So we decided to just now go into a study site, use that whatever road network there is, and then build your camera trap grid off that and try to do systematic spacing across the landscape. Sometimes you still have to cut trails, but if you're going to do that, we highly recommend that you hire local people that really can make a serious trail and not just like a kind of not a very good one like we did. The animals will come to use it, but it needs to be a pretty obvious trail. Okay, so this one just came from the field a couple days ago, so I had to pop that in there this morning, actually. So now the technique is pretty standard. So over time, we've worked to standardize these techniques. So we'll set up a trapping grid now. 20 is the minimum, although now it's becoming 30, 40, 50, 60 is kind of the minimum for some of these larger predators. Two cameras per station to get one each side of the animal to get make sure you get that spot pattern on both sides. Spacing, we could argue a lot about spacing, depends on the home range size of the animal. For us, we're using basically 2 to 3 kilometers apart. And then, at least for my studies, and actually most of the ones I've been involved with, you need about 2 to 3 months to get enough captures and recaptures that you can actually estimate population size. If you don't do it too long enough, you just don't get enough animals photographed. There's a lot of work in population estimation that I'm going to kind of skip over today because it's very mathematical, and that's what a lot of my lab is doing, is a lot of mathematical stuff about mark recapture and pushing techniques forward. So I'll highlight some of that, but I will spare you the math today. So when it's all said and done, you've got these dots of camera traps, in this case across Belize and various different study sites. You can buffer those camera traps in these areas. We've now expanded. These were some of our initial grids that went from 250 to 400 square kilometers. But in some of our areas, we're now up to 1,000 square kilometers. So we're covering huge areas now with camera traps. And we get lots of great species. So I'm not going to talk too much about non-target species, but we do get animals doing weird things. You always have to show the picture of who pees on your camera. Tapirs like to do that. They're just really strange that way. So there's multiple photos of this kind of thing happening. Okay, and then the great thing is you get all the camera trap photographs back. Here are some more non-target species, but we are targeting puma and ocelot, but there's also margay and jaguarundi in these study sites that the technique doesn't work very well on. We just don't get very many photographs of those animals. But we do get, by far, the most is jaguar, so the technique works very well for jaguars. And the great thing is that you do get nice quality images that you can then identify to individual. So this is what a lot of the undergrads do in the lab that work with me. They go through these photographs and try to pick out who is who. And so this to me is like super easy because these cheetahs are way harder than this. So jaguars are simple. So I'm sure you've all already got it. The two on the left are so obviously the same. They actually are, but for some people it's maybe not so obvious. But you'd be surprised at how many people still don't think that this is possible. So I have had grant proposals rejected because they didn't believe you could tell animals apart. But their spot patterns are really, really distinct. This guy with his snake eyes there, very obvious. Plus, he's always super fat. Yeah, and they're not hurting in this area, that's for sure. Another little anecdotal thing I wanted to throw out there about why this technique is so interesting is that here's a study site where three study sites that we're trying to connect in one gigantic grid. That's the one that's over 1,000 kilometers, and this animal was captured at all these little white. These are camera trap stations with the white little paw print is where this guy was captured, and his straight line distance was 37 kilometers. And the reason this is really interesting is because the previous radio telemetry work on jaguars said that their home range was only 10 square kilometers for females and 40 square kilometers for males. And I never believed that. And so, because I was like, that's impossible. They cannot be that small. And so here's some evidence now that they move over much larger landscapes than we thought before. And these areas are, this area is logged, logged, unlogged. They're all over the place. And so they are going through these mosaic landscapes pretty easily. So that is just a little bit of anecdotal evidence, but we're working that up right now to get more information. Okay, so getting back to some of the ecological questions here. So what I wanted to then do was estimate density. So skipping through a lot of the mark recapture and density estimation, suffice it to say that there are really variable densities in Belize, and that was the thing that I was hoping for, because I want to look at the three predators and see when jaguar density is high, is ocelot density low, etc. And so we go from 2.36 jaguars per 100 square kilometers up to the highest ever recorded in Coxcomb Basin of 10 animals per 100 square kilometers. And so this is, I thought this was great. This will be really cool for looking at mesopredator release or umbrella species concepts. So the methods are kind of the same for all these different case studies when I get to them, and I'm, again, not going into extreme detail. First, I'll just talk a little bit about trapping rates of the different predators, so how many photos do you get per 100 trap nights. Occupancy, which is a way of estimating distribution across your landscape, but you also need to account for imperfect detection. So this is a lot of work that I do in my lab is based on doing these occupancy estimations. We're accounting for the fact that species have different detectabilities and incorporating that into our occupancy models. And there's multiple different types. I'll talk about them as we get through: single species occupancy models, multi-season co-occurrence models, etc. And then the world that we're doing a lot of work in right now is mark recapture. So traditional mark recapture, which you may have learned even in an undergraduate class, now has morphed into the newer techniques of spatial mark recapture, which is incorporating locations where animals are caught into your modeling techniques. So those are things I'm happy to talk about later, but that's just the overview of the types of techniques I'm going to be talking about in the analysis phase as I go through some of these results. Okay, so first let's look at the only relationship we found with trapping rates. So this was it. It was where you have ocelots present versus no ocelots, and these are cross-camera traps, where no ocelots are found, you actually have higher jaguar trap success. So more pictures of jaguars at the sites where you've got ocelots. And that was it. That was the only relationship. We found no relationships in either direction for ocelots, pumas, or jaguars. So that was our one trapping rate finding, which was opposite of what we might predict, unless you think the puma is kind of mediating, and then maybe there's a indirect benefit of on ocelots of jaguars. And then just some occupancy data that's kind of doing two things here instead of one, and this is that I've got two different sites. The green is an unlogged site, and then the orange is a sustainably logged site. So I just wanted to look at occupancy. Again, this is how are they distributed across the landscape. A one would mean every single camera trap had those animals are predicted to occur 100% across that landscape, which is pretty much what we found in the unlogged site for all species. So we really found completely, you know, they're distributed at almost every single camera trap location, at least distributionally. But in the logged site, there's a little bit more variability there. They're really more at about 60 to 70% occupancy. So they're not using that habitat as much as they're using the unlogged site. So that was kind of interesting. But again, we're not seeing any trends in one area where we've got high distribution across that landscape of jaguars. We're not seeing that they're at least spatially excluding those other cats. So spatially, they're all pretty similar in their occupancy across that landscape. And so what I didn't show you the big table of we did a bunch of habitat modeling with that big AIC table that shows you, you know, what are the important features. So rather than show that table, I'll just tell you what we found in terms of our associations with habitat. And we found that ocelots, and there's a couple of different study sites. One really is pine forest. It's a natural pine forest. And then there's a broadleaf rainforest, like we consider rainforest. But in the pine forest sites, ocelots were positively associated with jaguars and pumas, So positive associations mediated by road. So the wider the road, believe it or not, the wider the road, the better. We had higher trapping rates and higher site use with wider roads, and then negatively associated with human use. So the more humans that were in there, the lower we had in terms of site use across those camera traps. The broadleaf sites were kind of similar. Positive relationships between pumas and jaguars. So again, positive, we're getting these positive associations again. Again, that same thing, mediated by roads, so the wider the road, the better, and cover, so the more canopy cover, the better as well. And then ocelots had positive associations with jaguars and pumas. So basically everything's positive. So this was a big surprise for us. We're like, wait a minute. So there's no negative interactions at all here. So that was a really interesting. So then we're going to move on to density estimates. So again, that was a site use, kind of an occupancy analysis. But now when we convert these to density, and I've only got three sites here. We're not quite done with all the other sites and all the years. And so these are just three that turn out to be pretty indicative of what the rest of the sites are showing as well. And that is that pine forest is not very good for jaguars or ocelots. Sorry, the reason I have to back up 1 second and say the reason that I don't have pumas on here is because it's really hard to identify pumas. They don't really have distinct spot patterns. So, and I've got a student that's working on new models to try to get around this. But we're missing this link right now, and hopefully we'll have it in maybe a year. So, but suffice it to say, the mountain pine ridge habitat, not very good for pumas, for jaguars or ocelots. Rio Bravo is an excellent site for jaguars. It's one of our high, kind of our medium site, medium high. And we also have really kind of high densities for ocelots. And then we've got an intermediate site that ocelots are intermediate and jaguars are intermediate. So the scale is different because we have a lot more ocelots in these sites. But basically, when you take out that mountain pine ridge, what we're seeing is these associations seem to be positive. And I can show you some long-term data here. This is what we're just starting to, one of my students is finishing up doing the ocelot numbers. And what this graph is just showing you is the left-hand pane is our older style of mark recapture. The right-hand pane is spatial mark recapture. So these are new ways to estimate density. Blue is ocelot. Red is jaguar. And then we've got a log site and an unlog site. So just two different sites. So a couple things about this. One is that the techniques actually are producing pretty similar density estimates. We were surprised by this. We thought we would have some differences. But in a way, that means maybe the traditional estimates were not too bad, although there might be more variability. They tend to jump up and down all over the place, whereas it seems like we have a little bit more stability in these spatial capture models. But the main take home in terms of the sort of mesopredator release is that these animals seem to more track each other than anything else. So we're not seeing like as jaguar goes up, ocelot goes down. It's the opposite. Jaguars go up, ocelots go up. Jaguars go down, ocelots go down. With maybe one exception here where there's a little bit of difference. But and if you plot these as a regression on jaguars on ocelots on jaguars, it's positive for all four of these relationships, just not significant. So it's interesting that we don't see these long-term density estimates. Well, two things. It doesn't seem like the populations are crashing. They just seem to be bouncing around, happy. And there are slightly different density estimates between logged and unlogged, but there's no evidence of mesopredator release here. So it's more that if jaguars are doing well, ocelots appear to be doing well. So where we're going with this this analysis is Chris Satter just finished his master's, and he's a little bit farther ahead in terms of all those ocelot densities are now finished, which is what I've showed you in the previous slide. And then the hard nut to crack, Chris Rowe is working on that, my other Chris, and he is trying to get density estimates for pumas, which is really hard. And so how he's tackling that is these animals have, some of them have spot patterns, or not spot patterns, they have some recognizable feature. In this case, those are all disgusting botflies, or sorry, parasite people. Those are botflies. And so we can use those within a survey to track our animals because we can tell them apart. We can't necessarily do it between years because those things will pop out and those will heal in patterns that are, sometimes you can see them, sometimes you can't. But many of our pumas have these botflies that allows us, or they have a kinked tail or a ripped ear that allows us to know for sure the identity of that cat But then we have a whole bunch of really clean cats that we can't identify. And so Chris is working on a class of modeling called mark recite models, where you sort of borrow the detection probabilities from these marked guys and try to apply it to the unmarked ones so that you can get a better density estimate, or get a density estimate at all from remote camera traps. So this is a kind of active area of research
code
right now.
Maroon test. This is the monthly test of the code maroon system. No,
I didn't do anything.
At this time. Okay. This is only a test. 12:30 p.m.
Okay. All right, let's transition into poo for a little while. So, on that note, so now I want to tell you, this is a little bit of another technique that we're using, and this is non-invasive genetic sampling. And I'm not a geneticist, but this has enabled me to establish a really great collaboration with a geneticist so that we can now try tackling genetic monitoring and maybe mark recapture and abundance and all of that. And so, of course, people want to see the scat dogs. I always got to show in a couple of pictures of the scat dogs and say a little bit about them, because it's pretty fun working with scat dogs for a short amount of time. It's not so much for 8 months what Claudia did, my PhD student who finished. Billy was a scat dog that he was an Iraq war dog. And they couldn't send him to Iraq anymore. He was getting too nervous, I guess, like PTSD or something. I don't know. And so they said, oh, he needs a mellow project where he can work outside. So he worked with us for a year. And he was great. But he had some issues that I can talk about later over a beer. And this dog we got the second year, which was much better, Bruiser. And Bruiser was a failed drug dog. so he flunked out of drug school, but not because he was a bad dog. The reason he didn't make it was because he would go into a house where there were presumed to be drugs, and he would jump on the tables and smash the entire place to smithereens, and they were like, oh my god, he's an outside dog only. So they switched him over to our project, where he did a great job, even found a poo inside that that little nice toilet there. So yeah, Bruiser was excellent, an excellent scat dog. And so we went with I always got to give kudos to Pack Leader. They trained my student Claudia, so she learned to be a detector dog handler. And then we rented these dogs, basically. And so we didn't really have any, there was nobody to ask in terms of how do you survey a site for scat. And so we basically had our cameras in yellow, and we just gridded our habitat. And then me and mostly Claudia, I went a few times to help her, would search each one of these cells about 7 kilometers. And she'd search everything all the way through the study site, get all the poop, and that would be our first encounter occasion for mark recapture. Then she'd start over and do that again. So she'd go through every study site four to five times. I mean, we had to be there pretty much 2.5 months anyway to keep the cameras running, and we wanted to have these concurrent, so that's how we decided to do that. One thing I did like about Billy is that he was really calm. Like, he would, when he found a scat, that was his reaction. When Bruiser found a scat, it was like, oh my god, the world was ending. He's very excited and crazy. So and then they work all day for this. That's it. So they have to be completely ball obsessed or some toy, obsessed with some crazy toy. In our case, we were lucky it was a ball and not some weird animal or something. And so you'd throw the ball a few times and then back to work. That's it. So that's the job. Keep going. So so here's some of our results from that study. And some of this, some of our genetic work is published. We still haven't gotten to the mark recapture work. These things take much longer than you think. But the main take home is that we got over 1,000 scat samples. Claudia walked 2,400 kilometers or 1,500 miles. and she got about 2 scats per kilometer, or about 4 per day on average. And let me show you the results for the number of individuals. So this was really exciting for us. So we were able to get, those are different study sites, and when you total them up, the N is number of individual jaguars. So we got 74 distinct individual jaguars that we recaptured 307 times. So really good data for mark recapture. And we got 56 individual pumas 161 times. And then we discovered quickly that the technique doesn't work very well for ocelots. So we had a lot more ocelots on remote cameras than we did genetics. Seems to work pretty well for jaguars and pumas, but not ocelots. And then here are our amplification success. You always have to, I always say, if you're going to do a scat study, just be prepared because only 61% of those scat samples amplify. So poop is really hard to get DNA out of. And so these, this is just a warning for anyone who wants to try to do this. You've got to sample much more than you think you need to, because a lot of that might not amplify. Okay, but pretty cool that from picking up poop on the ground, this is what we were able to get. And then we can go ahead and try to estimate density. But first, I wanted to just give you some results. Because we had the cameras and the genetics going, I'm going to give you three different study sites. And just suffice it to say, for the other study sites, it's pretty similar. But these were the most dramatic. And the cameras are on the left, and then genetics on the right. And one thing that you see immediately is that we don't get as many females, which are in pink, as we do males from the genetic technique. So in fact, here, we got no females. Occasionally, for remote cameras, you can't tell the sex because you don't have the right angle on the photograph. But with genetics, you should be able to. And so we just were not getting very many females at all. 8 females here, 3 there. 5 females here, none there. So this was a real surprise to us. We thought genetic techniques were going to go off trail, or we're going to go all over the place. We should be able to get more females than we could with cameras, and we were wrong about that. And it might be that the samples that were off trail could have been more female. We're not sure. We don't really know what's going on here. And it's a little bit disconcerting that the genetic technique, which we were like hoping was going to be great, might not be so great for some of these large predators. When you convert those numbers then to density estimates, you see this negative bias in all three of these density estimates via genetics. So we know that they're negatively biased because we got all these animals by remote cameras, but we missed a bunch of them in the genetic sampling. So anyway, so that's still, we're still working on, is there a way to improve these techniques? And that's you know, future work. But I will say one thing you can get from genetics that you cannot get from remote cameras very easily is connectivity across this landscape. So now we're going to look at genetic connectivity, and is this a real break here where there's all these people and highways, or are animals able to cross really? And how does that play into the greater La Selva Maya? So that is pretty cool. And so we started looking at what were the barriers, and are there barriers, and where would they be, and if there's fragmentation, do we need to put in some corridors or translocation animals or something? And I throw this picture in here because that jaguar lost his tail. It's just a weird picture. So he had one, and then he lost it. I don't know what that means, but it's kind of interesting. Okay, so just to jump right into our results from genetics, if you're not familiar with genetic techniques, these are just FST values, and you want the value to be, the lower the value, the better. That means there's little differentiation, meaning it's all one big breeding population, which is pretty much what we found for jaguars. There's a couple of spots maybe where you've got moderate differentiation, but in general, the numbers are all very low across this whole country. So that's great news that this is actually probably one population. Whoops. But the other thing that's pretty cool is you can also look at parent offspring, and so we would catch like a mother here and her son or daughter there, and so really interesting, or full siblings. So these big black lines are like how many times did we get a parent offspring, and these red lines are the full siblings. And so it's basically just showing you there's lots of animals moving across this landscape. It's pretty neat. If you want to do another genetic analysis called a structure analysis, and in this case we used a more sensitive test, we could potentially start seeing a breakage here. So in this case we're saying blue animals are one genetic makeup and the red ones are different. And where does that breakage happen? Between 2 and 3? Between 2 and 3 here. So it is actually where we predicted it. But this is a sensitive, really sensitive test that may, you know, might just be, I mean, we do think there's a lot of gene flow, but there might be a little bit of breakage there. The interesting thing for pumas, whereas it was in a different place, it was here, which was between 1 and 2. So this was the breakage here. So the pumas were, we're not worried about them. They seem to be able to cross through this area of lots of people and highways and things. Okay, so neat stuff from the genetics work. And we're not too concerned about connectivity right now. It seems like it's pretty good for jaguars and pumas. Ocelots probably, but we weren't really able to get a large enough sample size to do a whole lot with those. Okay, so that was kind of my tour through a lot of the work we have going on in Belize. And now I've got just two really kind of short segments on tigers and then Madagascar carnivores. And so I just wanted to highlight these a little bit. So I'm going to switch gears and go into what we try to look at these things now, this mesopredator release stuff in a couple of other ecosystems and with the same techniques. So I'm not going to talk about the techniques because, well, except with one exception, but mainly because they're pretty much the same. And with tigers, we were worried about landscapes. Which landscapes are they using? We all know that landscapes in Indonesia are being converted to oil palm. And so one thing was, do tigers even use this kind of landscape? So I'll give you a little bit of results on that with what we found. But again, these are large scale, again, large predators, large scale sampling. This was our grid where we gridded off this habitat in central Sumatra. And then I'm going to blow up each one of those. Well, actually, these pictures here are those cells that we surveyed. So yellow is plantation, and green is actually forested areas. And so what we're doing here is we're going to do a sign survey in these cells here and try to predict across the landscape in the unsurveyed cells where did these animals occur. And they're very big cells. They're 17 by 17 kilometers, and then these were our survey areas that we used in our occupancy models. And again, skipping through the models, we did, and just going to go kind of straight to the results, we did find that tigers preferred thicker understory. They definitely preferred forest. It was really hard to get them outside of forested areas. We did get them in acacia, but that acacia usually was older acacia with lower human activity and closer to water. So, and we didn't really find them in oil palm or rubber, which is kind of depressing. So just in the acacia plantations. But what we were able to do with this is then, now that we used some of our GIS variables in our surveyed cells, we could use those same GIS variables and predict across the landscape just by using sign surveys. So those surveys didn't really even incorporate the camera trap data. They were just tracks, scats, and scrapes of that tigers make on trees. And so it's a pretty powerful approach to go in and survey just for signs and then being able to predict where the animal's going to occur across the landscape. They're much higher likelihood in these darker areas. So the darker areas are what are going to be focused on in the new management plan for central Sumatra. Those are the areas that are trying to now be expanded, or these areas in between protected, whereas the white, very light yellow, is kind of too degraded to be to worry about. So that was just a little bit on how to use sign surveys to do a wide-scale tiger study. But what I was really interested in is getting back at this question of these co-occurring felids and how do they occur together in space. So I'm going to do the same kind of analysis, but a little bit more in depth with an occupancy analysis called a co-occurrence model. And this is camera trap data. So we camera trapped all these white squares, our camera trap grids across this landscape. And so if you're not familiar with co-occurrence models, we're just looking at where at the locations across the camera trap grid do the animals occur, and are they impacted by the presence of the other species? So these co-occurrence models are like a pairing of two on two. And so you're looking at the detection of the other species and the occupancy of the other species and seeing if it impacts your target species. So in our case, we're always assuming the larger predator is dominant and is going to suppress the lower predator, the smaller predator. And in these models, you can calculate a species interaction factor. And basically, the only thing you need to know about this is that we're going to look for, is that species interaction factor greater than one, which means co-occurrence, or less than one, which means they don't occur together across these landscapes. So these are really cool models that I'm starting to use a bunch more. So what I'll say here is that this little triangular diagram here are organized from the largest cat down to the smallest cat. So we've got Sumatran tiger, clouded leopard, golden cat, leopard cat, and marbled cat. So big to small. And then each one of these represents a pairwise comparison. So this would be marbled cat compared to leopard cat. And we're doing this co-species interaction model, and we're looking to see what's happening here. What is that species interaction factor? Is it greater than one, less than one for this pair? So this would represent the pair of golden cat, leopard cat. This one would be marbled cat, golden cat. And so what I've done is to interpret this is just highlight the only thing significant we found, which was all the green. And all that green was saying that there were positive associations between leopard cat and everybody else. So leopard cat loves everybody. So we have leopard cats everywhere and associated positively with all the other cats, and no relationships, positive or negative, for any of the other cats. So they were all basically occurring independently. So no real evidence of any kind of spatial avoidance across this landscape, really at all, and some positive associations. You can also do this similar analysis with time. So that was space before, now I'm going to do time. And so again, you can overlay species 1 onto species 2. And the more overlap they have in time will give you a higher delta. Can't really see it, but this is the overlap, big overlap areas. And then you can calculate what that delta is. And I can give you more about that later. So here's the same thing. These cats are organized largest to smallest. And these are overlap values, which really are just saying 61% overlap with the standard error, et cetera. And so the main take-home message from this slide is that all of these cats that are most similar in size to each other had an overlap on average of about 62%. But once you start separating out and getting farther apart in body size, overlap actually goes up to quite a bit, so 79, almost 80%. So cats that are closer in body size, so marble cat and leopard cat, so all these guys on that diagonal are closer in body size, so much lower temporal overlap than once that body size is separating. So that's really kind of the take-home message, that maybe we're starting to see something with temporal overlap that we didn't see with spatial. Okay, so to wrap up, that was a quick and dirty on felids in Sumatra. So just to wrap that up, some evidence of co-occurrence, but it seems to be, lots of evidence of co-occurrence, and some evidence of temporal segregation. Some other interesting features is that some areas we did actually get fishing cats, but they didn't occur in high enough numbers that we could actually include them in the analysis. And they tended to occur in separate habitats. So if you're going to promote diversity, some areas are really good for all the cats, which are the lowland rainforest type areas, and then some areas like the peat swamps were only good for fishing cat. Okay, but let's skip now to the last little bit, which is our ongoing work in Madagascar. And this is just a few slides to show you another analysis with multi-carnivore species and camera traps across this large landscape. So these are all 7 different study sites, again with big camera trapping grids, and also some of them have been surveyed multiple times, so 3, 4, 5 times. Lots of issues in Madagascar. This is a tough place to work, a lot of forest loss, you have a lot of human encroachment. There's also quite a bit of bushmeat hunting and poaching, so that's tough. And then the one that I'm going to focus on more is exotic species and feral cats and feral dogs as part of our carnivore community. And here is that community. If you're not familiar with Madagascar, they got all kinds of weird stuff going on there. So Fosa, Malagasy civet, Phalaenuc, Vontsiras of multiple kinds, and then the 3 introduced species, dogs, cats, and Indian civets. So a pretty rich carnivore community. And so since this was all camera trapping data, I'm going to skip right to those co-occurrence models and just give you our take-home message. So I'll walk you through this. Here's what we've got. We've got these 2 species paired against each other, feral dog, or dog that goes with humans, and that little Phalaenuc. And so what you're seeing in this is patchy habitat. And so as it gets more and more patchy, that indicates more fragmentation. So that's just how we decided to do it. And so this is super fragmented, and that's less fragmented. And the interesting thing is, this is occupancy when you have dogs of your native species. It's much lower. So the red line, your occupancy goes from 0 to about 30% when you've got dogs in that habitat. But when you don't have dogs, there's much, much higher occupancy of your native species. So it looks like dogs are suppressing the distribution of that species across this landscape. So that's kind of depressing. When you look at that species interaction factor, that should be like higher or lower than 1. It's always negative. So it's always less than, it's always less than one. So that means they don't co-occur together. So this is strong evidence that there is no co-occurrence or there is some type of avoidance behavior going on. And so this is the opposite of what we found in all the other studies. So we are not seeing positive associations, but the difference is these are exotic species. And then last thing I'll show you is how our carnivores changed through time. So this is now a multi-season occupancy analysis across multiple years at one study site only. Okay, so this analysis, I'm going to skip this slide because of time. We'll just go straight to the results on this, and these are our species here. There's the Fusa, the big one. And that one, you can see the occupancy is about 80%, and it doesn't really change. And this guy, the little Fusa fusana, it's about 100% occupancy, but it drops a little bit, but not much. But then the depressing thing for Madagascar is the crashes that we're seeing. And we really think we caught this crash as it was starting to happen. In 2008, the first year I surveyed, and then my PhD student took over from 2010 on. And we're seeing crashes in the four native carnivores, 80% occupancy down to 20, 50% occupancy down to 10, 80% down to 20, and same. So all of these really cool native species seem to be crashing. And dogs actually strangely stayed the same. But what increased dramatically was feral cats. We had no feral cats ever photographed in the first year of the survey. And then we have now up to 60-70% feral cats across the landscape. So that's really kind of shocking for Madagascar. And so the last thing that I want to show you is just what we're working on now. I've got to show the little video. It's cute. trying to combine the spatial analysis and the time analysis. So the space analysis was all that occupancy modeling, and then we had the time analysis that I showed later. And so how we've decided to do this is use a spatial temporal value where we're measuring the overlap in space and time by multiplying basically our results together from the two analyses separately. So since I'm running out of time, I'll skip through that, but we're going to conquer the space-time continuum, so I hope. And this is what it looks like in 3D. So here's our 3D graph of fragmentation here, hour of the day of activity, and then that spatiotemporal value. And so what this looks like for these two species here, and that's introduced species, the Indian civet, and then the little Fusa, Fusa fusana, is that we have basically a lot, this high spatiotemporal value here is indicating in fragmented habitat, we have, and especially at this time of day, we have a lot of probability that these two species are going to interact. So this is the time of day, and the type of highly fragmented sites in the evening is when these guys are most likely to have some kind of interaction. And we don't know, you know, what that interaction is going to lead to. If one's going to go extinct, drive the other one away, we're not really sure. But we're still trying to run these analyses now with a bunch of different other species pairs. So that's kind of what my former PhD student is working on right now. So that's work for the future. And so what I'll do now is just wrap up all the conclusions. In Belize, we had I think that Wikipedia got it right. So strangely, the jaguars do seem to work as an umbrella species. We're not seeing any evidence for mesopredator release. Jaguars seem to be an umbrella species. They're all using the same habitat, similar habitat features, and the densities seem to be kind of tracking each other. Sumatran carnivores, it seemed kind of the same. We didn't really see that tigers were any kind of negative influence on any of the other species. They may be just separating out in time. But we did not see the signature of some big mesopredator release thing. And in Madagascar, the conclusions were interesting. I would say that the Fusa could not be used in as umbrella species because we've got carnivores crashing while the Fusa is not crashing, but for a very different reason. It's for these new introduced species that have been relatively recently hitting that landscape. Okay, so that's what we're thinking about there. And then I'll end with some thoughts on this cheetah-lion thing that got me all interested in this in the beginning maybe that's only a thing that happens in these open savanna-like habitats where the lions can just see the cheetahs, go over there and kill their cubs. So maybe the reason there's not much evidence for it in rainforests is just they function differently. I'm not sure that's the kind of the best I've got right now. And that we only were able to discover all of this kind of new information by these non-invasive techniques that have previously made this kind of impossible to do. So we weren't able to do it until the advent of some of these new techniques. It's a really great time to be studying these carnivores because we've got now lots of new analytical techniques coming with marker sites, spatial capture, recapture, all kinds of things like that. New ways to collect samples, for example, non-invasive genetics, I think is only going to get better and better. And then combining these techniques together to do integrative modeling and combine, say, even GPS data with non-invasive mark recapture or something like that. Lots of other projects I didn't get to talk about. We just finished a project in Nepal, finished one in Virginia on coyotes. And so those, if you want to ask me about those kinds of projects later, you can, where we're using the similar techniques across these ecosystems as well. And so I guess that's how I wanted to finish up, by just saying thanks a lot for inviting me, and hopefully I've given you some insight into where what my lab is doing and all of the different ways you can use non-invasive sampling to answer these really interesting ecological questions. So, and with that, I'll be happy to take questions.
Any questions?
Yep, got one back there.
Have you seen any patterns in the U.S. with things like pumas and bobcats and lynx?
Oh, so some of the most interesting work in terms of that mesopredator release stuff comes from Yellowstone, and they've definitely seen, once wolves went back in that ecosystem, you had declines in pumas. So that is happening there, and I don't know why in that ecosystem in North America it seems to be a little bit more like Serengeti, where you've got this really top-down control predator. But wolves are a bit different than the felids. They really hunt in these big packs, and they're, you know. Yeah, great question. That's the only example I've got that I can verifiably say, yeah, they've seen this top-down control on other carnivores. Yeah. Oops, sorry, human man, go for you.
I wasn't here at the early part of the talk, but have you tried this kind of study with a large predator that can be found in both open and closed habitats, and like compare the data sets between the open and closed?
Yeah, you know where it would be really good to do that is Pantanal in South America, because that's very open habitat, and jaguars live in pretty high densities there as well. And I always thought, oh, it would be great to start another study. But yeah, that's a good idea, especially with the same predators. I think that's what we're missing in this, is like it'd be nice to do open and closed same predators. So yeah, we've got to talk to the people that work in the Pantanal. Yeah.
I guess sort of similar, but in between like the savanna versus these forested habitats, I know with the stat samples, are you able to do diet overlap? Like maybe it's not just that they're in the same place
yes.
at the same time, but
yeah, great question. When we originally got all those poop samples, we were so excited. My PhD student was going to do everything. And then, you know, those poop samples actually just stayed in the freezer. But the funny thing is, she's now analyzing those now, so many years later, and using molecular techniques to do the prey. So this is going to be really interesting because she's in the process of analyzing all those molecular, that data molecularly, to get prey identifications for jaguars, pumas, and ocelots. So that's coming. You know, it'll takes a little while to do that. But yeah, there's probably some diet separation for sure. Yeah.
Is it possible that those cat dogs were just less effective at detecting female fecal material because of hormonal makeup?
Yeah, I don't think so, because we did train them on both male and female jaguars. I mean, there is a thing in that we're getting the training samples from zoos, I don't know if they would affect male and female differently if they're in the zoo. I don't know why we get more males with the scat dogs, except that maybe the female samples, if they are off trail, those often didn't amplify as well. So they might be there and the dog might be getting them, but they might not. They seem to be more buried. Like when we got the DNA back, we think it seemed like there were more female scats off trail, kind of buried, as if they're trying to avoid males. We know that jaguars do infanticide, so females might be afraid to be around males, so they might just not be using the trails as much. And we just, interesting, with cameras, we get them occasionally, but with males, jaguars, we get them all the time on the cameras, whereas we'll get one fleeting female, but she's in there, we got her, you know, but we don't get a lot of repeated photographs of her. So yeah.
What's your proposed mechanism for the feral cats causing trouble? Are they killing the predators straight out, or are they just eating their food?
We have one anecdotal remote camera photograph of a feral cat with a native mouse prey. Small mammal. It's not a mouse, but I can't remember what it is. But so we know that they're killing prey, so it's running around with this. But I don't know if they're actually killing directly.
Those
carnivores.
The
sizes are pretty similar. They're pretty. I would say actually, feral cat is bigger than a couple of those other ones. So yeah, that's a good question. All those large mammals in Madagascar are like this big, except for the Fosa, which is like this big, you know, and very long and skinny. But they're much smaller than the bigger carnivores I usually work with, so similar in size to feral cats, or feral cat is larger. Yeah.
So on that, so you showed a decline over the years, but I know deforestation is also a huge issue.
Mm-hmm.
So has that been significantly increasing as of 2008? Have you noticed that could be impacting the populations as well?
Yeah, Madagascar, what happened in, so we didn't survey in 2009 because there was a coup. Government coup, so they couldn't get into the country, and that's why there's that gap there. And that coup led to a lot of problems, like a lot of people coming into the forest and a lack of enforcement, where they had okay enforcement, not great, really not much, but it was like complete absence of enforcement, and lots of people thinking, oh, now that there's a new government, we can just go into these areas. And I think that was part of it. I think that 2009 year was pretty important for the forests, because a lot of poaching increased and a lot of illegal timber harvest just by villagers and stuff going into those areas. So I think that we just happened to be not lucky to catch it, but we were there at that time. So that's what I think is going on there. Yeah.
Are the predators affected on Madagascar? Are they already listed by IUCN as endangered?
I think almost all of them are listed there.
Were they listed before, or?
Yeah. That's a good question. I'm pretty sure they were all listed, or they were data deficient, because there's just not hardly anything known. And some of this camera trap work led to range expansions for some species. They didn't know they occurred in those areas. So that they're just so little known about those carnivores that. But yeah, they're either data deficient or listed as endangered. Because everything's endemic there, that's one of those things that sends you into that kind of endangered status pretty readily. Yeah, go ahead.
Are you collecting scat in Madagascar too?
No, we didn't do any genetic sampling. So that would be an interesting component to add.
You might also be able to look at how the feral cats are introducing diseases to the wild animals as well.
There are some vets working on that feral cat issue, but they're just trying to get room. I say that nicely, you know. So anyway, go ahead.
Have you tried some of these methods with margay?
Oh yeah, we didn't get any margay, even though our scat dog was trained on margay and jaguarundi as well. We got zero jaguarundi scat samples, and then we only got like four or five margays. So it didn't work. For some reason, didn't work on margays. So I don't know. I don't know why. Yeah.
Have you ever considered using like some sort of individual recognition software instead of undergrads?
Yes. Yes. Actually, one of my undergrads, I said, look, you're going to do this job. So she's using a downloadable program called HotSpotter. I don't know if you've heard of that one, but it's a free download. And I wanted to use it before, but I didn't want to pay for it. So because undergrads were free, kind of. I mean, independent study, you know. So so now that the software is free, I have an undergraduate who's actually creating a database, and she's done it for ocelots, and it's working pretty well. So the computer program can ID them pretty fast. But it took her months to get the database up there. So it works great if you already have a database established to compare your new photos to this database. So I feel a little bit bad, though, because there's a sense of excitement in the lab when the new photos come and people are like, I want to do the jaguars. And I'm like, I'm going to have to take that away from you. It's a computer now. You have no independent study. So I have mixed feelings about whether I want to do that or not. You know? So, yeah, good question.
I think we'll stop there for the
Great.
Sake of time. remind everybody, happy hour, 4:30-ish, rough draft, North Gate. So if you have more questions for Dr. Kelly, that's the place to be. It might be happy hour or half hours, depending on how things go. So come on out and have a good time. And let's thank Dr. Kelly for her time.
Yeah, thank you.